climate change is a serious challenge, but it's not insurmountable. We're stymied in getting to the solutions because of an underlying challenge, a communication failure rooted in language and ideology. Some aspects of this failure are inadvertent and innocent, like how some scientists communicate. Others are intentional and insidious, like the active disinformation campaign. Other aspects involve ingrained worldviews. Resolution of this communication failure is essential, as it can unleash our ability to solve the climate problem. My thinking's evolved over the 25 years that I've been working in climate change communication. When I first started working with climate scientists, I realized that people had a hard time understanding some of them. I'd say, it's going to get a lot warmer, and how much depends on our emissions. And they'd say, mathematical model simulations of both explicitly resolved and parameterized properties suggest a range of global mean surface air temperature perturbations depending on assumptions about anthropogenic emissions and their radiative forcings. Further research is required. Did you get all that? So I figured if I could just help them translate science into English, people would get it, and then we could get on with solving the problem. Of course, that assumed that if people just understood the problem, we'd act to fix it. Turns out that's not the major issue. But communicating science to the public, it involves a number of things. Simple, clear messages in plain language, repeating them often, and communicating using stories, because they're sticky and memorable. But scientist training teaches them to use jargon and include all the details and caveats right up front. Never repeat what's already known, and the data speak for themselves. There's no need for stories. You can see the problem. Scientists are from Mars, the public's from Venus. But just like men being from Mars and women being from Venus, this doesn't mean that they don't love and trust each other, just that sometimes a little communication help is needed. Besides jargon, I realized that scientists used a lot of words that the public also used. They just used them to mean entirely different things, and no one had ever recognized this. So, for example, scientists often use the term positive feedback, which to most of us sounds like a good thing, right? You do a good job, you get positive feedback. But scientists use the term positive feedback to describe a vicious cycle in the climate system, whereby warming causes even more warming, so the process feeds on itself. It's not positive. And when scientists describe the possible ranges around a particular measurement or projection, they call those ranges error bars. But to the public, error just means wrong. I think when I retire, I'll open a tavern for scientists. I'll call it the error bar. I've identified 150 of these words that mean entirely different things to scientists than they do to the public. I've been talking about them for decades. I've even published papers about them. I worked with my scientist colleagues on lots of other issues in language and communication. We developed effective metaphors, and they became better storytellers. We designed graphics that people could actually understand. And all of these efforts have been really worthwhile. Some scientists are always good communicators, and many more have joined their ranks. Scientists have now clearly communicated that we know that the world is unequivocally warming, and we know the cause. We've increased the amount of heat-trapping carbon dioxide in the atmosphere by more than 40% through our dependence on coal, oil, and gas. And we're seeing the impacts now, in longer, hotter heat waves, in rain coming in heavier downpours, and our coastal cities beginning to feel the brunt of encroaching seas. And there's a lot we can do about it, both to reduce future climate change and to deal with its consequences. Scientists overwhelmingly agree on all of this. In fact, based on the evidence, 97% of climate scientists have concluded that human-caused global warming is happening. And scientists are not the only ones. The US military is very concerned about climate change. They call it a threat multiplier because it exacerbates a range of risks to our security, from the spread of infectious diseases to conflicts over resources and refugees. So with the facts so clear, how did we get into this communication crisis, and why are we stuck here? This is where the intentional and insidious part of the problem comes in. There is a well-organized, well-funded disinformation campaign designed to confuse and cast doubt on the science. There have been many books written documenting this campaign, including this one, which details how big-moneyed interests promoted a handful of scientists to obscure the truth on issues from tobacco smoke to global warming. The merchants of doubt take advantage of language confusion, like those words I mentioned that mean different things to scientists than they do to the public. Take the word uncertainty, for example. The disinformation campaign exploits the fact that the public use of uncertainty is, we're really not sure what's going on, even though scientists mean no such thing when they use it. Scientists use uncertainty to describe the possible ranges around a particular measurement, like those error bars I mentioned. And scientists use uncertainty to describe the range of possible warming that we face. A little more or a lot more, depending on our emissions. Scientists will call that the uncertainty range. But we are as certain that human activity causes global warming as we are that cigarette smoking causes lung cancer. Or take the word theory. Scientists use the word theory to describe something that's very well established in science and can be used to make predictions, like the theory of gravity. But the public usage of theory is much different. It's just a hunch or a guess, just some theory. So there are those who will exploit that by repeating that global warming is only a theory. Well, next time you hear that, remember, gravity is only a theory too. The disinformation campaign also misleads with divisive rhetoric and false choices, like pitting the environment against the economy, as if we had to choose between them. In fact, recent research shows that the costs of climate change to the economy are huge. So it's not just an environmental issue, it's an economic one. And while it will cost something to deal with, it'll cost a lot more if we don't deal with it. And the longer we wait to act, the more expensive it gets. So these are just a few of the ways that the disinformation campaign carries out its intensive effort to undermine public understanding of the science and the solutions, which leads us to another communication issue. The difficulty that some people have separating the reality of the science of climate change from how they might feel about some of the potential solutions. As I thought about the language that's often been used to talk about solutions to climate change, I realized that maybe it wasn't the science some people were rejecting, it was how they perceived the solutions. So words like regulate, restrict, cut, control, conserve, and tax. These are words that get some people's hackles up because they sound ideologically objectionable. I've been pointing to this problem for a long time, and a recent study supports my concerns. Researchers at Duke University's Business School did an experiment with self-described Democrats and Republicans. All the participants in this experiment heard the same science of climate change and projections of the future, but half of them heard that science coupled with a free market solution, and the other half heard it coupled with a regulatory solution. A majority of the Democrats agreed with the science, regardless of which solution set it was paired with. Among the Republicans, a majority also agreed with the science when it was paired with a free market solution. But those Republicans who heard the science paired with a regulatory solution were much less likely to agree with the science. Now, this is important information, and it suggests a more productive way to frame the solutions. For example, pricing fossil fuels to account for their real costs to society is a market-based way to drive energy innovation. But if you call it a tax, some people will be instantly alienated. Now, there are those who choose those words inadvertently, but others who want to stall action do it intentionally, wanting to get people's hackles up. Now, another problem that we face in the communication of climate change is that some people just don't recognize the immediacy and urgency of the climate change issue. At a talk I gave recently, someone in the audience said, "Well, we've been talking about this crisis for decades, and we're not on fire." No? Tell that to people in the American West, where the fire season's getting longer and the fires larger, and there are clear connections to climate change. Hotter, drier conditions, more insect-killed trees, and earlier melting of snowpack. My questioners seem to be under the common misconception that climate change was maybe a problem for the future. We'll cross that bridge when we come to it, he said. Oops. Gonna be tough to cross that bridge. We're seeing a lot more of this kind of flooding due to the increasing trend in very heavy downpours, and that's caused by warming, because a warmer atmosphere holds more moisture. All of these things are happening now. The problem is, not everyone is connecting the dots between what we're experiencing and the human influence on climate. And the media are not helping. When wildfires were ravaging the American West in 2012 and 2013, the media spent a lot of coverage on the firefighting efforts. But did they mention climate as a factor in the increasing trend in wildfires? Not so much. Just 3% of the firefighting coverage in 2012 and 6% of that media coverage in 2013 even mentioned climate change. Now, in addition to not connecting the dots, the media also give undue amounts of airtime to contrarian points of view. And in general, they just give the topic of climate change short shrift. The media may not tell us what to think, but they tell us what to think about, and it's not global warming. And for many of us, when people do think about it, they think of it as something far away, like melting ice at the poles and polar bears, something that affects someone else somewhere else. But it's happening here and now in our own backyards. You know, the Arctic is the opposite of Las Vegas. What happens in the Arctic does not stay in the Arctic. So that melting ice on Greenland, what that means for us is sea level rise and water in the streets of coastal cities, like New York and Miami and New Orleans and Houston. Houston, we have a problem. So what can we do? How can we take on this communication problem so we can tackle the climate problem? Well, one thing we can do is change the language that we use to talk about solutions to climate change. We can use words like innovation, entrepreneurship, American ingenuity and exceptionalism, harnessing the power of the free market, and rising to the challenge of competing in the global clean energy economy. These are things we can all support, so we can get together and get on with taking the actions needed to minimize disruptive climate change. In addition to the words, we can be more thoughtful about who is saying them. We can identify and promote trusted messengers for each audience. This will help because we all tend to believe what those who share our values believe. And climate change, unfortunately, has become part of the cultural divide that defines our identities. As we work to change how we talk to each other about global warming, perhaps we can bridge that cultural chasm that's opened up between us on this issue. We can connect on values that we all share. We all want a cleaner, healthier world, a vibrant economy, a better future for our children. None of us wants to leave our kids with a problem they can't solve. We need to create a conversation around these shared values and around how climate change is affecting all of us and the things that we care about, where we live, and in places we depend on for food, water, and other necessities. And we need to avoid thinking that this issue is insurmountable. It's actually empowering to recognize that we're the cause of climate change. It's a man-made problem, and it has man-made solutions. We can take that empowerment and focus on the great opportunity that we're presented with in the transition to a clean and prosperous energy economy. We've made great strides recently. The United States produced more power from wind in 2014 than any other nation. And the price of solar power has come down so rapidly that it's now cost competitive with conventional sources across most of our country. But other nations are moving even more quickly and producing larger shares of their energy with renewables. The global race is on, not only to deploy existing technologies, but to invent and develop new ones. Those who win the race to innovate will profit in more ways than one. The solutions to climate change are here and available to us now. And they offer such a wide array of benefits in addition to maintaining a livable climate. The benefits are so many, it really will be a better world. We just need to make it happen. And that starts with how we talk about it. Words matter. So it's time to change the words, so we can change the conversation, so we can change the world. Thank you.